It was the worst election-related violence in the country. Today, the Supreme Court is being criticized for what some say is continuing perversion of justice for disallowing a public trial of the case. Joining us today to give us insight is Philippine Press Institute Vice Chairman and Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility Trustee Verhel Santos. Hi, Verhel. Good to see you again.
Hi,
good morning.
Pinky.
All right. Let's clarify that. The ruling of the Supreme Court on no live coverage. What do you know about that?
Well, it has been reported that the Supreme Court has changed its mind and has decided to reverse itself by disallowing a public or open trial of the case. We haven't seen, I haven't myself seen the resolution, although the Supreme Court has not denied it and has been very widely discussed. Mm-hmm. I haven't even seen the vote because I'd very much like to see who voted how.
Uh-huh. And who reversed?
Yeah, exactly.
Who maintained?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. In any case, this to me is a very critical issue because this is the Maguindanao case. The trial itself transcends the issue of crime and punishment, you know, and the larger question involves civility and morality in political leadership and equality under the law. I mean, these are big questions.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that's why you can imagine that the public has been clamoring for an open trial, for the process to be put in the public light every step of the way, which, according to reports now, the Supreme Court is not about to allow. This to me is a very grave setback, not only for the case, but for the sort of democracy that we pretend to.
Well, you talked about crime and punishment. A crime was committed. Punishment will be rendered once a verdict is handed down.
Yes.
So that still forms part of your crime and punishment, whether this is an open trial or not.
Exactly.
Him. So,
but we'd like to see. We must all understand what sort of the normal flow of justice in this country. It's something. Justice grinds unequally
and very slow.
Very slowly. So that's why people would very much, because this is one case that the people would like to rally around for both justice and the quality of politics in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is to do with warlordism.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's why it has taken the... It has captured the imagination of the whole nation.
So how do you actually feel now there is talk that in the coming 2013 elections, the Ampatuans are going to run and maybe still actually win in some parts?
Very, very possibly. And this will speak of how much we have done this, the people of this country and the government itself, how much they have done, we all have done, to raise the quality of both justice and politics in this country. I mean, we only have ourselves to blame.
Yeah. Okay. But it's in the courts right now. Judge Solis is, of course, on top of the situation of the case right now. But for media, for journalists like us, there is something we can do. But for the ordinary folk, what can they do? Except really, you know, it's a psyche. It's a mindset of Filipinos. Years pass. They progress. Things are not really forgotten, but they're put on the sideline. You can imagine the first day this actually happened when we found out about it. The public outrage was huge.
Yes.
The emotions were high. But right now, 3 years later, look at what's happening. Even some of the victims' families have actually left the country.
Yeah, this is the kind of surrender that you will find in a society such as ours. I mean, when you have a society where justice precisely grinds so slowly and uncertainly, and where people of small means have little chance of getting their due,
mm-hmm.
I mean, you will understand why people are giving up. But for people who are put in a situation or are placed or are are in places where they could do something, the media, for instance, or people in government, leaders of advocacies, they should start inspiring and rallying people around this case. This is a very critical case.
Do you blame media as well for the lack of media?
Yes, I think the media only, most of the media are good only for commemorations, you know. When an anniversary falls, then you have something.
But let's talk about the anniversary of Rahel.
Yes.
That was yesterday.
It's today.
No, sorry. Yesterday was supposed to be the time that they were going to go to the site in Maguindanao, the site of the massacre. Even Governor Ismael Mangudadatu did not make it and refused to divulge details of his location.
Yes.
Very few people, I think, actually showed up at the massacre site where they actually commemorate it. I think that happened, if I'm not mistaken, that was yesterday. So here you are in a normal situation where even before, members of the administration would actually show up. I think it was Secretary Laila De Lima who used to likewise be there in the past couple of years. You don't have that right now anymore.
No, it's because this reflects the terror that continues to strike at the hearts of people in Maguindanao. You see how people in Maguindanao have become and looked
and
at this
fear.
Situation.
Mm.
Yes, this is. We are so far from it now. That's why we're marching.
Yeah.
We're marching today. I mean, it has. It's the security, the safety of distance.
Yeah, but that's what I'm talking about, Verhel. Even if members of the administration seem to be absent at the grave site and they were present then, how can you actually even encourage the families of the victims to be there as well? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It becomes actually even more difficult. Easy para sabihin na, sila nga, hindi na nagpupunta kami pa.
Leadership demands the presence there.
Even if there was a statement made by the head of the police there or the military saying, this is safe right now. I remember there was an article that I read very recently saying that there were 3 solar powers that were actually stolen from the site that was supposed to have been bought or donated.
Yes.
Solar powers that were actually
robbed.
Taken.
Exactly.
So, it just shows you, wala nakabantay doon. Yeah. Probably.
You know, soldiers choose the leaders they follow to war. You know, and this leader should be at the head of the front line. Mm. This is how it is. This is the essence of leadership, and you don't have it here.
Uh-huh.
You don't have it here. I mean, I'm not saying that the governor himself had been remiss in making himself scarce on such an occasion. I'm not saying that, but all I know is that leadership demands. I mean, if don't take up the mantle of leadership if you can't even do certain basic things it demands.
All right, so what we're left is this. Let's round it out because the numbers are actually varying. Let's look at 200 suspects.
Mm-hmm.
Half of them have been arrested,
mm-hmm.
more or less.
Yes.
Out of the half, maybe 4/5 of them have mm-hmm. been arraigned.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of them still mm-hmm. have not been arraigned.
Yeah.
And the other half is still at large. That's more or less about 100 of them. How does that make you actually feel, or the victims' families feel, knowing that half of the accused are actually still out there?
I can understand that you cannot round up all these people, considering that there are so many. But the core of the conspiracy, you know, the people at the core of the conspiracy, certainly could be easily determined. And it seems to me that the arrest, you know, the arrest of the Ampatuan father and son, was rather quick.
You know? Okay.
Was rather quick. Why? Because
there
the
were
crime,
reasons for that.
And also because the crime's so brazen. You know? It's so it's not something. It doesn't seem to me a particularly difficult puzzle to solve. I mean, in fact,
they made it easy.
Yes, they made it easy.
Okay.
I mean, you hijack a convoy, you force it off the road,
you're talking about a
away.
Long convoy.
Yes, a long convoy, 58 people, and then force them off the road, 2 kilometers away to a pre-dug grave. I mean, how brazen and confident can you get?
It's actually as if you lay down the trail for people
exactly.
to capture you.
Exactly.
Yeah, to solve the crime.
Oh, this
you
this,
made it so easy for everyone.
This is
to
such
do that.
Confident warlordism. You
yeah.
know?
Okay. So that there here comes the problem. Half of them have been arraigned, more or less. Half still remain at large. There are about 500 witnesses combined, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken, both from the prosecution and the defense. Mm-hmm. All right. Out of the 500, about a fourth only or 100 have actually made it to the trial. It's been 3 years.
Yes.
You have more or less 400 more witnesses.
No, I say deal with the suspects in hand. I mean, that's what justice is about. I mean, because by starting to look at those still roaming around,
mm-mm.
possibly leaderless,
okay.
because we appear to have in custody the core conspirators,
the core leaders. Okay.
Yes. So
what should be done right now?
So
that's my point. It's
proceed
been
with
years.
The trial.
There is of course the trial
a speedy
is proceeding.
One, you know.
But
I mean,
let's talk about
due process.
To be fair, yes, you
due
said
process. Due process cuts both ways.
For the accused,
I mean, what due process
and
for
the
accused, due process for the victims.
Okay, here's the point I was trying to make, Rahel. There are a number of petitions, motions, which actually really form part of any trial, for that
yes,
matter, even
yes.
pre-trial. These resolutions, petitions, come into play.
Yes.
There's been a suggestion to actually find another tribunal to look into all the documents, in other words, petitions, motions, resolutions. Are you in favor of something like that so that Judge Solis can just really concentrate on the trial proper?
Anything that will speed up the trial, I mean, I'm for. I mean, but to be unreasonably minute about it is another matter, you know, because you are opening, you are making openings for dilatory strategies, you know. This is a clear-cut case.
Mm.
I mean, you may even liken it to Corona's case, I mean, which was disposed of very quickly.
Mm.
Why? In fact, I thought there seemed no point to me for that particular trial.
You mean the impeachment.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there are such cases. This is not one of those cases that truly...
I see where you're going.
This is not one of those cases that truly boggle the mind. I mean, this is not something like...
It's not anything like that. And it's not even violent.
Exactly.
It's not the worst, single
exactly.
case of violence
exactly.
involving journalists.
58
yeah.
people dead.
Right.
Massacred,
yeah.
you know. Stopped dead.
Blatantly.
Yes.
Yeah. So and, violently.
And dumped into a common pre-dug grave.
Some of them
grave.
Were raped, right?
Some of them were even violated in death.
Yeah.
I mean, how
can
could
you...
Can you
imagine that? I understand that completely, but who's to blame for a situation like this? Let me go back to what I was trying to say, Verhel. If there are 500 witnesses for both the prosecution and the accused, prosecution and the defense, 100 of them have actually made it trial. That leaves you 400. 100 witnesses in 3 years. You have 400 more. More or less, I'll give you 3, 6, 9, 12. That should be 12 more years. But let's put it down to, let's say, 9 years. Are we ready? Are they ready for 9 years more of trial? For
even now, you see people giving up.
Yeah.
You know, how can we be ready? It's the nature of our society. It is embedded in the culture, which a culture that we want to kick. You know, some people try to kick habits. We're trying to kick a culture.
Mm-mm.
And you can imagine how difficult it will be. But all I'm saying is that the primary responsibility seems to me to lie in the hands that turn the wheel of justice, you know?
Okay.
So I don't really want to see, because it truly
right.
outrages me. to see the buck pass to the wrong people.
All right. Let me clarify one thing. I got a text and it said that Governor Toto Magudadatu is right now in the massacre site.
Oh yes, okay. this is the day.
Today. Yes.
Yes.
There was something I read. It was yesterday or the other day. That was the one I was talking about. I'll get back to that a little later on. I will dig it up in my computer. Okay. Uh-huh. So that's one problem.
Yes.
Let's try to go back, Rahel, when this all started, and we were thinking about the trial. I know we talked about it.
Yes,
we already knew then that this was going to take long.
Yes,
we were already.
We always presume because of our history, because of the history of slow justice, slow and unequal justice in this country. We were quick to be so skeptical. Well, we were skeptical because we wanted to show our skepticism to the people who can do something about it.
But apparently,
we really haven't gained much, not anything. And if indeed the Supreme Court is intent on disallowing a public trial, what little gain made is erased.
Mm-hmm.
And so what now?
All right. I'm trying to connect to my computer to find out about that story. But anyway, let's go back to our discussion. So from here on, we have a problem. It seems that there are some people. Well, obviously, a number of them are still fighting together with their defense lawyers.
Oh,
for the journalists, Hattie Rocket.
Oh yes, yes.
You know, and a lot of questions come into mind. Number one, these people, the families of the victims, actually. They're not from here. They have to fly to Manila to be able to. Yun na lang eh. Yung pamasahe nila, yung pagkain nila, where they actually.
And
actually, the time that they have to commit and dedicate to be able to show up in a trial. And when they get there, possible delays, usual delays that actually occur. So,
you know,
this is the kind of trial that we are faced
with. It's a good thing that that some people have taken up the fight for these orphans, you know, and some people are helping very substantially in raising the lot of these orphans and in helping them get their due justice.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good thing, and then the number of news people. How, you know, this is one case that should not simply be reported in the bold and unemotional and detached sense of journalism.
Yeah.
You know, this is an advocacy.
Yeah.
You know, this is an advocacy. I mean, this is one case in which news people should ask themselves. Are we for truth and justice?
Yeah.
Are we biased in favor of truth, justice, and democracy, or what?
Or what can we do?
Yes.
How much passion can we put into this in order to to also bring this to fore and not make people forget?
Yes.
I don't think people forget. People are just probably...
Some people do forget, really, it seems to me. Because it's convenient for certain people to forget.
Yeah, because hindi naman talaga nila ito nakakalimutan, Berhel. Pero nawawalan siguro sila ng passion at emotion that they used to have in the beginning.
At saka they have their own other urgent and survival
pressing
preoccupations.
Issues. Right, right.
So yung iba nawala, tumulong naman.
Okay. So let me ask you this then. What can Malacañang do? I mean, if you ask Malacañang, obviously, they'll say that it's in the courts. It's with Judge Solis already, hindi ba? What can the Supreme Court do? Those are my two questions for you right now. Top of your head, what can be done to hasten the process?
I don't see enough outrage from Malacañang, for one thing. And two, and such shortage of outrage reflects, certainly, the level of interest that it has in the case. I mean,
why do you think? Like why?
Well, probably Malacañang is just like the people of this country. They have their own priorities or preoccupations, you know. And in certain cases, the priorities are lopsided. And I dare say that Malacañang's priorities, to a certain extent, are lopsided. I mean, FOI, right of reply, and Maguindanao massacre, you know. I mean, you hear the president saying that if you are a proper journalist, you must have, you must not be afraid of a right of reply law.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I say if he's a proper president, you should not be afraid of FOI.
Without a reply.
Or without a right of reply. Yeah. It's the same. It cuts both ways.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's another topic.
That's another version. But
altogether.
All the same, these are the things that, I don't see outrage where there should be one properly.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah,
I don't see that, and it is to do with priorities as a nation, as a people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you have 58 people dead in the most scandalous way, odious way, you know, and you have nothing to say.
Let me throw the question back to you, Verhel. Then, for someone like you. Why not also, is it financial considerations or time element issues also that you, you're not over there also commemorating?
Yes, yes. But I joined the march today.
Yeah, because actually there are two different marches
exactly.
I think here in Manila. Another problem that, is being highlighted by journalists, the NUJP for that matter, is that I think they're going to be, they had marched or are going to march about 157, if I'm not mistaken, 158 coffins.
Coffins, yeah.
I think it's 158.
From Duelcom Rotonda, yeah.
Because of the 158 journalists killed in the Philippines since 1986.
Exactly.
Okay, so that's another issue.
Yes,
but, you know,
it's another issue.
Going back, there are 32 that were killed.
32 in one go.
Yes. Kaya the single biggest, most violent.
Yes. And it was, you know, it happened to a democracy convoy. There was this wife of a candidate filing
the certificate of candidacy for the governor.
So dramatic, you know? So it was effectively a democracy convoy.
What can you say? What can you then say about armed men still? You know, it was Secretary Ricky Carandang who had said in today's report that out of the 112, armed men, that has actually been, the DILG has actually reported that has dwindled down to about 60 or about 50%. Very hard to also, mahirap din naman talagang labanan yung that kind of problem, but at least Malacañang saying, you know, we've cut that in half.
Well, you are giving me numbers. I mean, you're not even giving me the quality of these guns, you know. You are not even giving me the quality of the characters of the people who are holding these weapons.
Okay.
These have to be taken. I only have to be a decided murderer with a little gun to do a lot of damage. I mean, it is nothing to do with that. I mean,
okay.
I don't like the whole issue to be reduced to numbers, because numbers mean nothing in this case.
Okay.
You know?
And they're not very easy to understand.
No, not easy to understand.
Right.
And people will not identify.
Yeah.
These things are not resonant at all.
All right. It's been 3 years, and it seems like this is going to be something that we will still be talking about.
Oh, yes,
in the years
probably.
To come, and maybe even. Siguro patuloy yung pagreklamo din ng tao in this snail pace that this case is going.
Yeah, voices will be raised, probably not enough, because there will never be enough. And in societies such as ours, there will never be enough, because people have their own survival preoccupations.
Mm-hmm.
You know? All I'm saying is that we probably shouldn't stop, and we should raise our voices often and high enough, and we should direct that to the proper people, like in this case, The people who are turning the wheels of justice. That's what I'm saying. And the highest leadership in this country. I mean, I think Malacanang does not seem to realize what it can do.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And what it has probably to do.
What kind of pressure?
To move certain processes.
All right, Berhel Santos, thank you so much for joining us this morning. And of course, we'll continue to monitor the developments of this case. And yes, it's been 3 years.
Yeah.
Quite disappointing, obviously, for those who have had to carry the pain of losing a loved one. For people like us, obviously, certainly, quite easier, only because we are not directly involved, or we had nobody we love that actually perished in such a horrible and violent manner.
Yes.
So again, Berhel, thank you.
Very thankful being here.
Right, and of course, not only ABS-CBN, but every media outfit for that matter, and every newspaper.
There is no reason for any media organization not to be part of all this.
Right. Thank you, Berhel. Thanks a lot.
My pleasure.
Employees are reminded of taxes on Christmas bonuses, and Paolo talks about genetically modified organisms, or GMOs. Stay tuned. You're watching Mornings at ANC.